welcome to Scandinavia.
Thank you.
Actually, you are here now with a strong friendship.
Yes.
But your story started with a horrifying event. And I wonder if we could start with that. If you can take us back, Jennifer, to this summer day, in summer night in 1984.
I had gone to bed early that night, and sometime around 3 o'clock in the morning, I heard a noise in my bedroom. And when I looked to the left side of my bed, I noticed a person's head. I could hear him moving around on the carpet. So I said, "Who is that? Who's there?" And at that moment, a man quickly jumped up and jumped on me, and I screamed, and he covered my mouth with a gloved hand and put a knife to my throat and told me to shut up or he'd kill me. So I tried to offer him my car and my credit cards and my money, that I wouldn't call the police, he could just leave. And that's when he told me he didn't want my money. And I knew what was going to happen. I knew I was going to be raped. But what you don't know is, are you going to die? I decided at that moment that I wouldn't die there, that somehow there had to be a way to live. And if there was a way to live, I was going to figure it out. But while I was trying to figure it out, I was going to pay attention to what this person looked like. Because when I lived, I was going to make sure he was found and he would be put in prison forever.
And you managed to give a very good description. And that description fitted your face.
Yes.
And I wonder, when you heard that the police were looking for you, because you worked in a nearby restaurant, right?
Yes.
What did you do then?
You know, my mother's boyfriend told me, he said, "Ron, the cops are looking for you." I said, "For what?" And he told me, for rape. I said, "I haven't committed such a crime." And once I entered the police department, you know, I identified myself, and I was approached, and they identified themselves. So they took me upstairs and interrogated me, you know, and asked me my whereabouts on this night. Of course, at the time, I was a very young man, 21 years old, and at that time, you know, I was a party guy. You know, I liked to go out and have a good time. You know, it was on the weekend, and that's what I done. I went out to the dance club and danced, you know, so I got my weekends confused. And so they thought I was lying. So they said, "Well, you're telling a lie, we got you." So I said, "Well, whatever."
So you never got to leave that place?
No.
When they had caught the guy and they sentenced him to life, did you feel some kind of revenge? Did you feel happy about that? Or how did you feel about that?
Well, I felt very happy. I mean, yes, revenge. I hated him. I mean, he had not only raped me, but he had raped a woman within an hour after me. And so I felt I needed to get him off the streets. I needed to protect the other women in the community. And so when they sentenced him to life in 50 years, it was...
It was actually based on you identifying him in a line.
Well, it was based
on... The classic
on,
line you can see in the movies.
It was based on a composite sketch that I helped the police do that led to a suspect, that led to a photograph lineup, that led to a physical lineup. And I was able to pick him out every time.
Do you remember standing in that line?
I do.
And understanding that you were identified?
When I stepped up, you know, I got real nervous. Why, I don't know, but I was real nervous. My legs were trembling, you know, because I'd never been put in a situation like that. So, so when she wrote it down, showed the detective, he walked over and showed it to my attorney. And my attorney, he dropped his head. Once he dropped his head, I knew I had been selected. So I stepped back, and that was it. That's all it took.
After serving some of the time, another prisoner came to prison, called Bobby Poole.
Yes.
And you became suspicious.
Yes, I was walking in the prison down a tunnel.